Okay, hello and welcome to this video on the SPT framework. This is the second video in the series that's going to cover the SPT framework, how it works and operates. And in this video, we're going to concentrate on object-oriented programming. The SPT framework relies on it heavily to allow the development of a framework in the first instance. So it's important that everyone using it understands at least the basic concepts of how and why things have been done the way they've been done. So from the first video, you'll recognize this slide. Again, we're recapping the knowledge that there are a number of tools, methodologies, technologies that exist in the IT software development space that are slowly being pulled across into the automation PLC development space. And our adoption of those known now systems will give us a lot of benefit in our own coding practices. From the first video, we obviously have the elements that happen at the design phase. So this is your object-oriented programming, UML integration, your frameworks. This comes in at the stage where you're literally designing the code that's going to run your machine. When you're actually programming the machine, in your coding phase, that's when your programming conventions, so what your company applies as your programming conventions, so your naming conventions, for example, how you use variables, what type of variables, how you make structures, etc., will come in, along with your source code management, Git, or any other sort of source code tool. And finally, you've got your test and optimization phase. Once you've written the code, how do you analyze how good it is? That's where your static analysis tools come in, see how well you've agreed with the your programming conventions that are rule-based on what your company requires you to do. Profiler, see how good and efficient your code is, and then automated testing for your test and development, so you can actually make sure the code does what you say it's going to do before it goes on a real machine. And what we're concentrating on today is the object-oriented programming paradigm, okay, which is a tool to increase your software quality. So there are a number of paradigms that exist in the programming world now. There are effectively three: structured programming, object-oriented programming, and functional programming, which is beyond the scope of what we're going to look at today. So structured programming is basically what you think of as classic PLC. It's well-structured, separated modules. So you have a main program that calls a program that runs some process. It then has sub-functions that it can call. And every time you move from one to another, you pass control to that particular function. So your main program calls your safety program. Your safety program is then in control. That then pans back to your main program, which then calls the motion program that runs the motion for the machine, and so on. Okay. That contains a mixture of local variables, so each program has its own set of variables, but then you need to be able to pass data between them, and that's when you start using global variables. Now that can be problematic, because if you don't do that correctly, that's when you can change things in one program that another one needs and give yourself a headache. Object-oriented programming doesn't think about the world in that way, in that process structured way. It thinks about it as objects, so exactly how we would think about the real world. So it uses objects and data structures bonded together, and it uses the interactions between them to effectively program a machine. So it designs computer programs by using the concept of objects interacting with the real world. So for example, a object would be an axis, or a button, or a seam crimp, or a lift, or a heater, for example. And the object-oriented programming paradigm uses the what it refers to as the four pillars of OOP, which enable you to create robust and maintainable code. And by implementing these, you'll be able to make much more reliable and scalable software solutions. So the first one is this principle of abstraction. Now, abstraction is really simple. It simply means hiding away the implementation detail. Effectively, the way to think about abstraction is that we're trying to create something where we don't care how it achieves what it achieves. We just want to be able to use it. So for example, if you had an axis, you don't care how it does an absolute positional move. You just want to be able to tell it to go to a position. Okay, so all the detail of how it does that move, how it actually calls the various function blocks from a library to implement that move, how it talks to the NC in TwinCat's case, is hidden from you. All you do is have a command that says, go to this position. Encapsulation is the art of effectively enclosing something together in a single entity or capsule. It basically means that instead of having data hidden in different functions or in global variable lists, all the data about a particular object, its state, its parameters, etc., is kept inside the object with the implementation code. So I come back to your axis example, your acceleration, deceleration, the starting, stopping, etc. states are all kept inside the same object as the one that handles the actual absolute move that you've just commanded. And it's a good way of keeping code organized and separate from the rest of the system. So you hide all implementation away and encapsulate it in a module or a class. And that's then how the only way we can talk to that is then via the methods and that it makes available. Inheritance is a very powerful tool, and what it basically allows you to do is pass the properties and abilities effectively of one class to another. So for example, taking our axis class, we could do that, have that and inherit another axis class that adds some extra functionality, but it gains all the base functionality from what we refer to as the parent, the original one. Okay, and what that allows you to do is maintain really nice, close coupled hierarchies of implementation. Okay, so let's take your axis class. Let's say it just does move absolute. You want to be able to do move velocity. You inherit from that, so you still have the ability to do move absolutes. All the things to enable, disable, reset, etc., you've implemented in the one that can do the absolute positional move are still there for your velocity, and then you can add to it using inheritance. And that's a way of giving you a really good way of not repeating code, okay? Because you could obviously just make another function block and copy paste all the code in, and that would be a waste of your time. And lastly, the fourth pillar of object-oriented programming is polymorphism. It basically means having something that can take on different forms. And that sounds really complicated. Effectively, it means that you can take any object and they will behave exactly the same as any other. So coming back to the example I just gave of the two axes, you've got the absolute one and you've got the velocity one, but they both obey a very basic interface that allows you to enable, disable and so on, which means you could pass either of them interchangeably into a state machine handler for your axes and bring them up into enable mode or disable them as and when you need to. Okay, so let's now apply those things to a SPT framework implementation. So we'd have our main machine at the top level. So we would encapsulate all of the data and all of the functionality of our machine into this one class that effectively has overall global control of our machine. It also maintains a state, whether that could be like a PacML state, for example, and maintains all the data about the machine that can then be exported to HMI and so on. Okay. Now it doesn't care what the other subcomponents do or how they work. All it needs to be able to do is interact with them and extract data from them. Okay. Those subcomponents would obviously be the equipment modules. So the equipment modules then are their own classes. They encapsulate their own functionality and abstract it away. So how the filling station does the filling, the machine doesn't know or care. All it wants to be able to do is tell the machine, the filling station to fill a product, for example. Okay. Or that a product is there to be filled. How it then achieves that is irrelevant to the machine. Okay. And go one further down, the same thing is true of the equipment modules and the components. The conveyor belt, for example, for the filling station or for the palletization station, the class of the filling station doesn't care how the conveyor belt works. All it wants to be able to do is to tell the conveyor belt to move or not move so they can bring product into the fill station. All of the code that makes the conveyor belt actually run is all abstracted away and encapsulated inside the component that is the conveyor belt. Okay, so how it makes a conveyor belt move using the move velocity, for example, how it maintains its state machine, etc., is all hidden inside that class. Okay, and the equipment module doesn't care how it operates, it just wants to be able to use it. Okay, and then we could go one further with that and have another axis class that's then a rotary table, for example. But what the benefit of using something like inheritance or polymorphism is that we could then interchange them because they have the same basic implementation of how they do enable and disable, for example, and reset. So the same handler for doing your enabling your axes and checking that they're okay and doing the status updates could be the exact same for both of those classes. Okay. Hopefully that's been a really high level overview of object-oriented programming and given you a bit something to think about. If you have any questions, feel free to get in touch with us. Otherwise, see you in the next video.